ज्ञानञ्जनशलाकाया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपकदामयहं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं वन्देहं श्रीगुरु श्रीयुतापदकमलं श्रीगुरुन् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातां सहगना रघुनाथान्वितां तां सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनासहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवम् श्री राधा कृष्ण पदान सहगना ललिता श्री विशाखान्वितांश्च हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधु दीन बंधु जगतपते गोपेश गोपिका कांता राधा कांता नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी श्री राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृष्ण भानु सुत देवे प्रणमामि हरि प्रिय वंश कल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा
हरे कृष्णा।
ओके सो वी आर डिस्कसिंग द 16th चैप्टर एंड लास्ट टाइम माताजी कंप्लीटेड 16.9 सो टुडे वी हैव टू स्टार्ट फ्रॉम 16.10 बट बिफोर वी स्टार्ट आई जस्ट वांट टू गिव अ लिटिल कॉन्टेक्स्ट बिफोर वी गेट इनसाइड 16.10 So we are discussing the section of this chapter where Krishna is talking mostly about the qualities. So he has already discussed the divine qualities and now he is talking about the demoniac qualities. And it is significant that he started speaking about the demoniac qualities in verse 16.4 and it is almost until about 16.20. You know, he will continue to speak about the demoniac qualities. So almost about 16-17 verses he speaks about the demoniac qualities, and the acharyas they mention that, you know, when we read the Bhagavad Gita, we can't see the emotions, you know, that are being exhibited by Arjuna and by Krishna. For us it is more like plain text, but the acharyas, they can feel that emotion, that the flow of emotions, the exchange of emotions between Krishna and Arjuna. So there are sections where Krishna become ecstatic. So the 9th chapter, 10th chapter, Acharya explained that when Krishna is speaking those verses there in the 9th chapter, he's ecstatic because he's talking about his devotees, his love for his devotees. And then they also explain that when Krishna is talking about these demoniac qualities here in the 16th chapter, he's really angry. And therefore we see that in the verse 16.20, Krishna speaks a very harsh verse for the demoniac people. So I'm not going to jump the guns, but I just wanted to, you know, bring this to the attention that Krishna is angry when he's speaking these verses, when he's describing about the demoniac qualities. So he started speaking about the demoniac qualities in verse number 16.4. And, you know, it is significant. He started with Dambha Darpa Abhimanascha. And Pyari Prabhu, actually, if you remember, he was giving the class for 16.4. And he explained that actually these qualities that are being described in 16.4, they are, you know, almost exactly opposite to what is being described for the divine qualities. So, you know, the verse that comes in 16.4 is Dambha Darpa Abhimanascha Krodha Parushyam Evacha Agyanam Chapi Jatasya Parth Sampadam Asurim. So, Sampadam means it is like a treasure. You know, these demonic people, they treasure these demonic qualities. So, Dambha Darpa and Abhimana Krodha Parushyam Evacha. So I think Pyari Prabhu explained that day that, you know, there in the divine qualities, we had, you know, Jnana Yoga Vyavasthitihi, and here we have Agyanam, you know. Agyanam means, you know, Agyana is basically cultivating ignorance. And, you know, Jnana Yoga Vyavasthiti means the divine people, they cultivate knowledge, and here they cultivate ignorance. And then also we have Mardanam Reed. Mardanam Reed means it is like modesty. And here we have Parushyam. Parushyam means harshness. So modest is like being humble. And here it is, they are very harsh. So anybody remembers what Srila Prabhupada gave the definition of humility in the 13th chapter? Very classic definition Prabhupada gives there. In verses 13.8 to 12, the first quality that Krishna speaks for the Gyan Yogis is Amanitvam. Amanitvam means humility. And Prabhupada defines that. Anyone remembers what is that? The definition that Srila Prabhupada gives?
Is it not expecting the gratification of honor from others?
Yes, Mataji, that's right. It's a very nice, actually, explanation. Humility means that one should not be, Prabhupada says, anxious to have the satisfaction of being honored by others. So that is humility. And here, you know, we have Abhiman. So I think Pyare Prabhu also differentiated between Abhiman, Darp and Dambha. So Abhiman means when a person has some qualities, he kinds of, you know, he expects some honor in the return of those. Like, you know, I have these qualities, I should be respected for these qualities. So that is Abhiman. Darpa means a person does not have that quality actually, but he still, you know, like shows off, you know, the, like, you know, false pre- so that, you know, I'm not humble, but I try to pretend to be humble. So that is Darpa. Who try to cheat others, you know, that is Darpa. And Dambha means, I'm sorry, that is a Dambha. And Darpa means, you know, you basically flaunt, you know, you may have some good qualities and you flaunt it. Like some people like to flaunt their wealth, that they will buy good cars and, you know, they, you know what it is in India. And Delhi, it is said it is the capital of flaunting. You know, everybody wants to flaunt in New Delhi. So that is more or less the culture in New Delhi. So, and then again, we have here, we have Akrodha. You know, in the people who have divine qualities, and in the demonic qualities, we have Krodha, like exactly opposite qualities, you know. So that is how Krishna starts describing the demonic qualities in 16.4. 16.7, you know, Krishna speaks something very, very important. He says, Pravrattim cha nivrittim cha janana vidurasuraha. You know, Pravrattim cha nivrittim cha means they don't know what is to be done and what is not to be done. And why is that? Because once you give up scriptural, you know, platform, when you don't have guidance from the scriptures, you know, you just are left to your own, you know, judgment. You know, we can see here in US, in different states, there are such, you know, different rules, you know, exactly in some states, there are so different rules because there is no scriptural guidance there. You know, people, they come up with their own, you know, you would think that why there should be so much diversity in the law in different states, but because there is no scriptural guidance. So for example, nowadays there is this, this hot topic about abortion, whether abortion should be legal or illegal. So, you know, there is so much in different state, we have different kinds of rules for that. And now if a person wants to get abortion done, you know, so he can go to another state and get it done. You know? So, you know, and then this has become like a scandal. If you have seen that news a few years back in China, they found there is a full scandal that was running. Once you make this, these things legal, what they found is they found some bones and, you know, and decomposed bodies of the babies who were still in the womb, like fetus, basically. Like they were very grown to a large extent. So what they found is, you know, these, they had a, like a full nexus of doctors. So when these pregnant ladies, they would come for their checkup, for their regular checkup when they're pregnant. So these doctors will artificially give some medicines during the checkup and the baby will die inside the womb. And then they will tell that, oh, your baby has already died inside. And if you don't abort it now, it's going to be a problem for you. You will die also. So they will take out the babies. And then what they will do is immediately take out their organs there, which are still in the formative stages. And using this, what is that technology? They basically try to develop those organs artificially. I'm missing the name of the technology now. And then they will import it to rich countries like Europe and America, you know, and then they will try to sell those organs. So they have found this whole nexus in China. So what happens is once you take out these, the scriptural guidance, you know, where the chaos will lead you, you have no idea about it. So this is what Krishna has been saying. Pravrittim cha nivrittim cha. And then in 16.8, Mataji had taken last week on Friday, Mataji had taken, I mean, Vallabhi Gopi Mataji, asatyam apratishtham te, you know, and then jagat ahur anishwaram. So asatyam means people think that, you know, these people think that this world is false, you know, it's not real. And that is also actually the philosophy of Mayavad, you know, Brahma Satya Jagat Mithya. So asatyam apratishtham. So basically, at least the Mayavadis think that, okay, the foundation is Brahman. But the Buddhists, they think that there is no foundation at all. Apratishtham, Acharyas explained that basically refers to Buddhism also. And Anishwaram. Anishwaram means there is no God in control. So that is atheism. And why they think, okay, you know, why this world is being created? Kam ahetukam, you know, just, you know, the purpose of this world is just to satisfy your lust. No, actually, I also had come across this philosophy once. I don't remember when, but I was reading somewhere where a person had written an article about lust, you know, how to control lust. But basically what he wrote is, you know, this lust cannot be controlled because you are born out of lust of someone else. You know, it sounds a little convincing. Therefore, you cannot control lust. And this is what you have been born out of. And, you know, this is going to take control of you anyway. So better is not try to control it. That is what the conclusion of the article. So I was so surprised that these kind of philosophies they come up with. And then, you know, they take shelter of these kind of philosophies. And, you know, it becomes their philosophy. This is their default philosophy. 16.9 also is, you know, pretty heavy. Actually, 16.7 and 8, Prabhupada also gives very, heavy purports. We had read those. 16.9, Krishna says, Prabhavanti Ugra Karmano. These people are born for the destruction of the world. The devotees, they are born for the deliverance of the world. But these people, they are born for the destruction of the world. So very, Krishna, you can see the kind of language he is using. It's very angry in one sense. That is what we have discussed so far about the demonic people. And let's now look at what is Krishna saying in 16.10. I'm going to share my screen in a second. Are you all able to see my screen now?
Yeah, we can see.
Okay, yes. All right. So we can recite this verse. You can repeat after me. Kamam ashritya dushpuram.
Kamam ashritya dushpuram.
Dambhamana madanvitaha.
Dambhamana madanvitaha.
Mohad grahitva sad grahan.
Mohad grahitva sad grahan.
Pravartante asuchivrataha.
Pravartante suchivrataha.
Kamam ashritya dushpuram.
Kamam ashritya dushpuram.
Dambhamana madanvitaha.
Dambhamana madanvitaha.
Mohad grahitva sadgrahan.
Mohad grahitva sadgrahan.
Pravartante asuchivrataha.
Pravartante suchivrataha.
Kamam ashritya dushpuram.
Kamam ashritya dushpuram.
Dambhamana madanvitaha.
Dambhamana madanvitaha.
Mohad grahitva sadgrahan.
Mohad grahitva sadgrahan.
Pravartante asuchivrataha.
Pravartante suchivrataha.
Anyone would else like to recite?
Kamam
ashrita tushpuram. Kamam ashrita tushpuram.
Dambhamana danita.
Dambhamana madanvitaha.
Mohan grahita sadgrahan.
Mohan grahitva sadgrahan.
Pravartante shuchivrata.
Pravartante shuchivrata.
Kamam ashritya dushpuram.
Kamam ashritya dushpuram.
Dambhamana madanvitaha.
Dambhamana madanvitaha.
Mohad grahitva sadgrahan.
Mohad grahitva sadgrahan.
Pravartante suchivrataha.
Pravartante suchivrataha.
कामं आश्रित्य दुष्पूरम्
प्रवर्तन्ते अशुचिव्रता
काम आश्रित्य दुष्पूरम् प्रवर्तन्ते शुचिव्रता
Okay, let's recite the synonyms. Kamam.
Kamam.
Lust. Ashritya.
Ashritya.
Taking shelter of. Dushpuram. Insatiable.
Dambha.
Of pride.
Mana.
And false prestige.
Madanvitaha.
Absorbed in the conceit. Mohat. By illusion. Grahitva. Taking. Asat.
Non-permanent.
Grahan. Things. Pravartante. They flourish.
Ashuchi.
To the unclean.
Vrataha.
Avowed. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Taking shelter of insatiable lust and absorbed in the conceit of pride and false prestige, the demoniac, thus illusioned, are always sown to unclean work, attracted by the impermanent. Purport. The demoniac mentality is described here. The demons have no satiation for their lust. They will go on increasing their insatiable desires for material enjoyment. Although they are always full of anxieties on account of accepting non-permanent things, they still continue to engage in such activities out of illusion. They have no knowledge and cannot tell that they are heading the wrong way. Accepting non-permanent things, such demoniac people create their own God, create their own hymns, and chant accordingly. The result is that they become more and more attracted to two things, sex enjoyment and accumulation of material wealth. The word Ashuchi Vrataha, unclean vows, is very significant in this connection. Such demoniac people are only attracted by wine, woman, gambling, and meat eating. Those are their Ashuchi, unclean habits. Induced by pride and false prestige, they create some principles of religion which are not approved by the Vedic injunctions. Although such demoniac people are most abominable in the world, by artificial means, the world creates a false honor for them. Although they are gliding toward hell, they consider themselves very much advanced. Namo Vishnupadaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhaktivedanta Swami Iti Namane Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Desha Tarine. I'll read the translation one more time. Taking shelter of insatiable lust and absorbed in the conceit of pride and false prestige, the demoniac, thus illusioned, are always sown to unclean work, attracted by the impermanent. So again, it's a very heavy verse and a heavy purport by Srila Prabhupada. कामम आश्रित्य दुष्पूरम, दे टेक शेल्टर ऑफ काम. कामम आश्रित्य इज अगेन इट्स वेरी सिग्निफिकेंट, इट्स एग्जैक्टली ऑपोजिट टू वॉट कृष्णा हैड सेड अर्लियर अबाउट दी डिवाइन पीपल. यू नो अर्लियर ही हैड सेड इदम ज्ञानम उपाश्रित्य, नो द डिवाइन पीपल टेक शेल्टर ऑफ ज्ञान, एंड दे हियर दे आर सेइंग कामम आश्रित्य, दे टेक शेल्टर ऑफ लस्ट. And what kind of lust? Dushpuram, you know, insatiable lust. No, the lust by nature itself is, you know, insatiable. But they basically try to provoke more and more and more. And dambhmanam adanvitaha, you know, and they are always in mohad, mohad. You know, and what kind of moha? You know, asad grahan. You know, they take the impermanent body to be eternal. You know, and then they try to satisfy the bodily needs. And then pravartante ashuchi vrataha, they always engage in unclean vows. Prabhupada says that this is a very significant verse. We might think, and what kind of asuchi vrata are there? Vrataha is there. What kind of unclean vows are there? So actually, few years back, I remember there was a very unique news I saw in the news. There are so many Guinness World Records that are being made. Even in our temple, I think. In 2012 or 13, there was some Guinness Book of World, Guinness record that was made in, I think, in the Mumbai temple it was, about some kind of drawing competition was there. I exactly don't remember. But at that time, I also saw another news, you know, which is, again, there was a world record that was being made, and it was very peculiar. What it was is, there was a couple in Thailand and they kissed each other for 47 hours. And, you know, and that became like a international news. And it was glorified so much. You know, this couple, they have made the Guinness, you know, they have made the world record, and their name have come in the Guinness Book of World Records. You know, now what can be more unclean than, you know, there is, you know, sweat and saliva and smell. You know, what could be more unclean than this? You know, and then the problem is, you know, we say that, okay, in Kali Yuga, there is sin, that is the problem. But actually, that is not the actual problem of Kali Yuga. You know, there was more sin earlier. And if we take these descriptions that are given in the scriptures about, say, Ravan, you know, Ravan could do possibly more sins in one day, you know, more than what all of us could do in our whole life, you know, combined. He could do more sins than that. The sin has been there always in all the different yugas. The sin has been there, but the problem of Kali Yuga is that, you know, sin is, you know, glorified and glamorized. You know, that is actually the problem. And then that when it becomes glorified and glamorized, as Srila Prabhupada says here, you know, he says that, you know, although they are gliding toward hell, they consider themselves very much advanced. You know, this kinds of becomes a norm. You know, this is what is the, you know, that kinds of becomes the culture also. And then people start to, you know, start looking towards these kind of things. So now another problem in Kali Yuga is, so in the, we know that in the, until the 16th and 17th century, the religion was very prominent, especially in the West. You know, Christianity was like kind of holding the fort. But after the 16th and 17th century, when this, you know, the scientific development started happening at that time, Christianity started losing ground. Especially there were a lot of, Christianity actually had come up with a lot of, you know, theories about things, and they were empirically disproven by science. And at that time, science was, you know, being started, you know, people started considering science is, you know, as actually the boon to the mankind. When their lives started becoming a little more easier, a lot of things were being invented, you know. But later on, what happened is, so we had the pre-modern era, then we had the modern era, and now we are in the post-modern era. So what is this postmodern era now? So in the modern era, people had a lot of faith in science. You know, they started considering science as the pillar of the, you know, it's more like a blessing to the mankind. But then later on, there were a lot of earthquakes that happened in the arena of science also. Now, what kind of earthquakes? Now, we know that in the science, there are two kind of, we could say, philosophies. You know, one is, which was given by Einstein, which is the theory of relativity, you know, E is equal to mc square, the most famous thing. And then later on, after that, what happened is quantum physics started coming in. So quantum physics, if you see, it is very different and almost opposite to the theory of relativity. The theory of relativity, this is not a science class, but just to give a little more context about what happened. So theory of relativity considers that there are particles, you know, that is what is required for theory of relativity. But in the quantum mechanics, what happens is they consider that everything is waves. So it is, and the problem is, although these sound a little opposite to each other, but though both of these theories, they work in their own, you know, in their own arena. So if you remember, Einstein had given one of the last statements of Einstein was that, you know, I would like to believe that there is ground below my feet, but something like that. He said that, you know, but as far as I could see, I can see no ground. It feels as if the ground has been taken away from below my feet. So what he referred to is, you know, when this more and more proofs started coming in for the quantum physics that everything is wave, you know, so he started. So anyway, we are not going to go into the details of it. But later on, what happened is, you know, the greatest insight that was given by the greatest scientist of the world, you know, so we had Einstein, who was considered to be the greatest scientist at that time. And the greatest insight that he had given is E is equal to mc square, theory of relativity. And using that, what happened is the greatest man-made disaster of the 19th century came in. And that disaster was basically the atom bomb. When atom bomb was used, you know, it was such a chaotic, you know, earlier I had just read when I was like a little boy, I had read it in my science books, that atom bomb, when it was in an exploded, it created terrible destruction. But later on, I saw on YouTube, there is a movie, not a movie, actually, it is a, what do we call it? More like an educational movie. So there I was so, you know, horrified looking at the destruction that was caused by these two atom bombs that was dropped in Japan. You know, they were mentioning that there are people who evaporated. And so many people died at that time. And then we know that there were repercussions even so many years after the atom bomb. You know, people were born malnutrition, you know, not deformed with deformed bodies, etc. So this scientific advancement, when it led to the greatest disaster of mankind at that time, people's faith in science becoming, you know, start losing faith in a sense that, you know, science also can cause destruction. So that postmodern era, what is there is people don't have faith in practically anything. At least in the pre-modern era, they had faith in religion. In the modern era, they had faith in science. Now in the postmodern era, what happens is, you know, whatever works for you, you know, just, you know, don't tell me what I should do and what should I not do. You know, whatever works for me, you know, if something works for you, I can try it. But if it doesn't work, just get out of my way. I don't want to do it. You know, so that is like the kind of the mindset. And I was actually, so we in ISKCON, we do so many outreach programs. You know, we do so many retreats, and many actually Westerners, they also come and attend these. So I was trying to see the reviews of the Westerners about one of the retreats that happened in New Vrindavan. So I found some common themes there. So what these people had said is, no, it felt so nice there, you know, it was so good. We had really good time. But, you know, after some time, these people try to take control of you. They start demanding that you should do this and you should not do this. Because what happens is, you know, people want experiences, and Krishna consciousness gives them experiences. But Krishna consciousness also demands lifestyle changes. You know, we have to change our lifestyles. Otherwise, you know, we might get some initial, experiences in Krishna consciousness, but it will not last. So the lifestyle changes, sometimes they are, you know, very, you know, it's very significant in a sense, very radical lifestyle changes for people. So one of the reviews I've read, the name of the person was Paul Bolton, you know, very, and he said that these people are good. You can go in and take some experiences, but as soon as they try to tell you that do this, don't do this, then just run from there, you know, don't wait there. So he's written in a very funny way. So, you know, that is kind of the postmodern mindset. So, and if you see the book that is written by Radhanath Maharaj, the journey home. Actually, when I was reading this book, and I realized that actually this book is kind of written in a way that appeals to the postmodern mindset. You know, the Maharaj doesn't say in his book that, you know, you should do this, you should not do this. Maharaj basically says that, you know, this is what I did and I had these experiences, and, you know, basically he's telling his own story. So he's not, it's not like a little, not preachy in a way. And then that has become such a big hit in the even with the Western, you know, audiences. So that is like the mindset of people. They don't want to make any radical changes in their lifestyles. And that kind of becomes their default philosophy also. So I'll quickly stop here and see if there are any questions or comments about what we have been discussing so far.
I just have one comment to add to what you were saying. The pet comeback for all the young kids and the modern generation is, you know, negativity, you know, positive. Everything has to be positive, you know, and anything that might like tell them something to do, like something to follow, that's like negativity, you know. I don't want to hear negativity. Like if you do this bad might happen. Obviously, no, that can never happen. You know what I'm saying? That's negativity. So even if it's the truth, it's negativity for some reason, you know, which is like really not very intelligent at all.
That's right, Mataji. What you said is completely right. And, you know, sometimes people say that even our philosophy, they say it's very pessimistic in a way. When we say that this word,
yeah,
our word, this word is, you know, dukhalayam ashashvatam.
Yeah, exactly.
So pessimistic, you know, just
exactly. That's another word they use, pessimistic. So right. Pessimistic and negativity is, I hear so much from the younger generation whenever you want to tell them something, you know.
Right. Yeah. What science is actually doing is, you know, it's basically trying to make their life easier in a way that, you know, sense gratification is more accessible and it is more, you know, attractive. That is what science has done. But actually, if we see, science has not solved any problems, real problems, as Prabhupada explains, the real problems are birth, death, and old age and disease. So none of these problems have actually been solved by science. And we see that we are living right now through this pandemic. And practically, there is so many months have passed, and, you know, still we don't see an end to it. You know, everything is, it's kind of increasing in India. It is deteriorating day by day now.
But still, the philosophy of the day is eat, drink, and be merry while it lasts, you know.
Exactly. Yeah. People are dying in thousands, so it's still people.
Yeah, still but, eat, drink, and be merry while it lasts.
Right. But again, you know, there are also, if you see, especially in Christianity, you know, one of the things, I was reading this book, I'm missing the name of Maharaj who wrote this book, very nice. So he writes in his book, this book is meant for the atheist, basically. And he writes in his book that the primary reason of atheism is religion, you know, and he explains that actually, and when the religious people, they don't behave appropriately, then that also gives right to atheism. So he explains that, for example, we know that in Christianity also, there are so many scandals that have happened with, you know, kids and all that. Even in Islam, there are so many scandals, and we have seen the similar scandals in, you know, in our in Hinduism, Hindu tradition also. So when these religious people, they don't behave in a proper way, that also gives right, because, you know, when you come, you know, people, they think that, okay, if a person is wearing saffron, you know, that our spiritual uniform, you know, then he is automatically, you know, like a saintly person. But when he kinds of deceives people, then people start losing faith in. And if one religion does something bad, you know, all the other religions also, you know, they also get discredited because of that.
No, I agree. Like my neighbor is an atheist because she had the Catholic religion, you know, the scandals with the children, you know.
Right.
That's what disillusioned her completely to the religion, you know. So you're right. And I actually wanted to bring up something. We recently recommend it to go through a video at our office, which is called The Brand. I actually want to send it to all of our devotees. I was reading it, and I was reading to that whole brand video and document, it says that you should behave in such a way that your brand is not damaged. You know, and that everything that was said there, Ganpati Govind, could be applied to our ISKCON. and our brand. You know what I'm saying? In a sense, ISKCON is a brand also. Yeah. You know, so the way we be as an organization, the way we behave, the way we, you know, portray ourselves, the way we welcome people, the way, you know, we do not like push people or, you know, pressure people, all that is our brand. You know what I'm saying? And every single page in that PowerPoint, I was just reading it and I was like, oh, we could apply it to our, you know, I could apply it to as an ISKCON devotee, you know. So every single page, it was actually a wonderful document. I'm going to try and see if I can lift
yeah,
it somehow.
You send it,
obviously, I can't forward it to anybody, but I think I can take copies of every page. You know?
Yeah. Or you can give a class on that document.
I'm actually going to look at that document. And, you know, it was so good. It was really a good, very good document, how to actually protect your brand.
Yeah. And another thing that I have seen is, especially in the Christianity, you know, they have come up with these doomsday philosophies, you know, the world is going to end, you know, and take shelter of Jesus. And actually, there was this May 21st, 2011, that was very famously, if you remember, they had come up with this idea before 2011, that May 21, 2011 is the last day of the world and the world is going to be destroyed. Take shelter of Jesus. But then what happens is when these theories are empirically disproven, then people who are following the religion, it becomes like a test of faith for them. And people who are not the followers, for them, it becomes like a laughing stock. You know, similarly, there was this it's a famous preacher who lives in a New Haven area. He is a professor in Yale University. Last year, I was watching a video on YouTube. He had made a full video, and he, according to him, April 10 or something, 2019 was the last day of the world. And he came up with, you know, so many, I was watching this video, he was quoting from so many different Christian scriptures. And then he came up with a full, like a story that how the world will be destroyed. So he mentioned that, you know, Russia and China, they will team up and then they will attack on US, and before attacking, they will use EMP. So all the different, you know, their airports will shut down and the whole electricity will go off and they will not be able to defend the attack from China and Russia. And when China and Russia will attack, then the allies of USA, they will also attack the other. So that will, it will become like a world war, and then ultimately the whole world will be destroyed. So this is the time, take shelter of Jesus. So these kind of doomsday conspiracies, you know, theories that they come up with, that also kinds of discredits the religions, you know. And what happens is not just that specific religion, but all religions. You know, these kind of doomsday preaching, that doesn't work with the modern mindset, definitely not, the postmodern mindset. So what happens with the postmodern mindset is the education is like that, you know, everything. It teaches us to basically doubt everything. You know, if we see something, the first thing is to doubt that, you know, whether it is whatever is being told, is it correct or not? You know, that is like a default mentality that has become with this. So what happens is, with this kind of a mindset, you can actually find out, okay, what is not right with something. But then it will not let you understand what is right. You know, you can only know what is not right, but you know, if something is right, you should be able to understand that also. So this postmodern modern mindset, that also is a like a problem. Any other questions or comments?
No, Hare Krishna Prabhuji, we learned about demoniac you know, nature, and which is like the opposite to knowledge, and lustre and dambha and darpa and all these things that exist in us, the demonic people. That's what it says here right now. So that's what Krishna describes. Right.
Yeah. Those are some other things that we discussed, definitely, Mataji. Yeah.
Yeah.
So if no one else has any comments or questions, we can move on to the next verse. We still have some time.
Okay.
Anyone has any comments or questions? Okay. All right. So I will share my screen one more time. These are verses 16.11 and 12. We can repeat it just once and then we'll read the translation and we'll move on from there. Can repeat after me. Chintam aparimeyam cha.
Chintam aparimeyam cha.
Pralayantam upashritaha.
प्रलायान्तं परिषदः
कामोपभोग परमा
कामोपभोग परमा
एतावद् इति निश्चितः
एतावद् इति निश्चितः
आशा पाशशतैर्बद्धः
आशा पाशशतैर्बद्धः
कामक्रोध परायणः
कामक्रोध परायणः
इहान्ते कामभोगार्थम्
इहान्ते कामभोगार्थम्
अन्यायेनार्थ सञ्चयम्
अन्यायेनार्थ सञ्चयम्
Translation: They believe that to gratify the senses is the prime necessity of human civilization. Thus, until the end of life, their anxiety is immeasurable. Bound by a network of hundreds of thousands of desires and absorbed in lust and anger, they secure money by illegal means for sense gratification. Purport: The demoniac accept that the enjoyment of the senses is the ultimate goal of life, and this concept they maintain until death. They do not believe in life after death, and they do not believe that one takes on different types of bodies according to one's karma or activities in this world. Their plans for life are never finished, and they go on preparing plan after plan, all of which are never finished. We have personal experience of a person of such demoniac mentality who, even at the point of death, was requesting the physician to prolong his life for 4 years more because his plans were not yet complete. Such foolish people do not know that a physician cannot prolong life even for a moment. When the notice is there, there is no consideration of the man's desire. The laws of nature do not allow a second beyond what one is destined to enjoy. The demoniac person who has no faith in God or the super soul within himself performs all kinds of sinful activities simply for sense gratification. He does not know that there is a witness sitting within his heart. The super soul is observing the activities of the individual soul. As it is stated in the Upanishads, there are two birds sitting in one tree. One is acting and enjoying or suffering the fruits of the branches, and the other is witnessing. But one who is demoniac has no knowledge of the Vedic scripture, nor has he any faith. Therefore, he feels free to do anything for sense enjoyment, regardless of the consequences. So I read the translation one more time. They believe that to gratify the senses is the prime necessity of human civilization. Thus, until the end of life, their anxiety is immeasurable. Bound by a network of hundreds of thousands of desires and absorbed in lust and anger, they secure money by illegal means for sense gratification. Again, very graphic explanation given by Krishna. So, chintam aparimeyam, you know, they have unlimited fears and you know, anxieties. So what happens is the lust, you know, when the lust is not satisfied, it becomes anger and, you know, and wrath, as we have read in the second and third chapter. And when the lust is satisfied, what happens? Anyone knows? When the lust is satisfied, what does it lead to?
Anger.
No, when it is not satisfied, then it leads to anger. But when it is satisfied, what does it lead to?
Greed,
yes.
Yeah,
so greed. What happens is, with the lust, you know, it is like, you know, when you do sense gratification, when there is like some kind of the desire for sense gratification is there. And when you fulfill that desire for sense gratification, so it is like adding fuel to the fire. The senses become more and more powerful, you know, and then they demand more, you know, and then there will be a point where, you know, the desire for sense gratification will not be fulfilled. And at that time, it will become anger and wrath. And then if it is fulfilled, then, you know, a person wants more and more and more. For example, people who are, you know, Prabhupada, many places there he writes about, you know, womanizers, uses that word. So what happens with these womanizers is if a person, they're having some kind of an illegal connection with a woman. So how can he please a woman? He can please a woman by, you know, by wealth, by showing off his, you know, he has so many things. So if he has to please that woman, he has to acquire more and more and more wealth, you know, and we have seen, you know, and read, and, you know, even when people who are, they legally get married, you know, our expenses increase many fold when I was living alone versus now when I have a family. You know, now my salary would be 10 times of what I was earning before, but still my expenses sometimes, you know, it becomes very difficult for me to, you know, maintain, you know. But a person who has illegal connections, for them, you know, it is just impossible to, you know, and then what happens is to satisfy those kind of expenses, then they have to acquire money with, from illegal means. And that is what is mentioned in this verse. You know, Anyayan is Artha Sanchaya. Artha Sanchaya means acquiring wealth, and Anyaya means by improper means, basically, unjust means. You know, and then it says Kama Puhog Parama. You know, people think, these people think that Kama Puhog, you know, sense gratification is the primary need of, you know, of human existence. Now, we know that the primary need, at least in India, at least few years back, it was roti, kapda and makan. Roti is bread, kapda is cloth, and makan means shelter. We should have a shelter, you know, like a roof over, above our head. So that those were the primary needs. But nowadays, the primary needs is, the most important is mobile phone. You know, even if you see a beggar in India, you know, he will still have a mobile phone in his pocket, you know, and that is true actually. And, you know, when I first came to US, that was back in 2008, I believe. So my company, you know, these corporates, they have their CSRs. CSR is corporate social responsibility. So they do a lot of, you know, social service kind of works. So my company had tied up with Travelers Insurance, and, you know, they had come up with Travelers. It seems they was running a, they were running a program. So what they will do is they'll find the most poor household in the, you know, in the town, and they will go to that household and they will try to do something for them, either paint their house or, you know. So my boss told me that, you know, we need at least 6 people to go and participate in that as part of our CSR. So you have to go. So I said, okay. I was new, I couldn't say no, and I was excited, and I'm going to do some social service. So apparently they have zeroed on the most poor household, you know, in the town. And I went with a team over there, and what I saw is, you know, we started doing some work, but as we started going inside the house, I saw this person has 3 cars. You know, one is like a brand new red color car. Even at that time, even I didn't had car, I was going with bus. He had 3 sofa sets. I went to his kitchen, you know, his kitchen was full of, you know, all kinds of food, vegetarian, non-vegetarian, you name something, it's there in his kitchen. And then the other thing I noticed is his house was so dirty. And then I was thinking, you know, this is the most poor person in this town. And I was thinking, in India, you know, people don't even have enough food to eat. He has 3 cars, 2 sofa sets. And, you know, I didn't have that time. Now, of course, when I discussed with my boss, you know, what kind of this CSR is there? So he tried to pacify me by saying that, you know, this is all relative. You can't compare America with India. You know, but again, we have to see that, you know, what is the prime necessity of life? So for people, kama bhog parama, you know, it is like sense gratification is the primary need of them, you know, for them. And then they have determined this, etavat iti nischitaha, you know, they are determined to do sense gratification. And asha pasha shatair baddha, you know, they are tied to so many, you know, network of desires. The desires cannot be fulfilled, you know. And then finally, what they do is anyayen artha sanchayan. You know, they basically acquire money by unjust means. So I think it's almost time. I should stop here and see if there are any questions or comments.
So recently, Prabhuji, if you remember, 2 weeks back, due to storm, there was outage for power and internet. And I was, after that all storm is kind of almost done, then I was speaking with my manager, who is American. Olivia! And he was like still having an issue with the internet problem. And the way he explained to me is if internet is like, they're like, we can say like oxygen, right? So every day we take oxygen, that's how they treat internet.
Exactly.
And
yeah.
He was trying all alternate ways. And I learned something new, like you can order something on Amazon, which you can use for some alternate internet arrangement. And he was thinking on those lines. he was very worried about how his kids will survive without internet, because usually they don't spend time with their kids in self engagement. Usually they use electronics to, you know, engage right. their kids, and that was like too much for them. I mean, they get restless. If everything come on them, even to talk to their kids, and they get restless. So these are some of the like a practical scenario that we see, like how that is not so deeply rooted about those material pleasures in the form of whether internet or anything. These are small things in our day-to-day life. So thought to share something.
Yeah, that's interesting, Prabhu. And actually in this verse is one other important thing that Krishna says. He says, Kama Krodha Parayanah. Earlier, in the earlier verse, Krishna had said, Kama Ashritya Dushpuram. You know, they take shelter of insatiable lust. And here Krishna is saying, Kama Krodha Parayanah. They become devotees of Kama and Krodha. You know, people, we are meant to be Narayan Parayanah. We are meant to be the devotees of Lord Narayan. But these demoniac people, they basically become devotees of Kama and Krodha. So, and then because of that, you know, when they take shelter of this, such kind of things, and then they think that, you know, sense gratification is the prime necessity. Without this, you cannot live. You know, this is, how can you live without sense gratification? That becomes like the default philosophy. Thank you, Prabhuji. It's nice sharing. Anything else? Any other questions, comments?
Thank you, Prabhu, for explaining everything. Have a nice night.
Thank you, Madhuri. Thank you for joining. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Ganapati Govinda Prabhu. Thank you.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Wonderful class and connecting with the modern context and everything is so nice. When you were mentioning about, you know, the science and the pre-modern society, actually, this is one of the things that Srila Prabhupada has defeated. An Acharya with big A is somebody who defeats all the contemporary philosophies. And the contemporary philosophy that was thriving at the time of Srila Prabhupada was science. And you could see he keeps on attacking them. And this is one of the traits of the founder Acharya, is who defeats this dominant philosophy at the time. Shankaracharya defeated Buddhism like that. So Srila Prabhupada took on this science, and therefore all of the devotees who come to Krishna consciousness, you know, their faith is stronger because, you know, Prabhupada has addressed this challenging contemporary philosophy so very well. And I'm glad you were bringing up all these points, going back to the, you know, time of the Second World War and everything, and how things have progressed. Thank you, very well connected.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Prabhupada especially, you know, repeatedly talked about this Darwinism. You know, he smashed it so bad. I mean, because Darwinism was like a direct attack on the existence of God. So we see that repeatedly Prabhupada mentioned in his purports, in his lectures, he talks about Darwinism. And then he smashes that philosophy completely. But what you said is completely right, Prabhu. The Acharyas are meant to basically defeat the, you know, the demonic propensities and philosophies that are existing at that specific time.
You know how people say that religion is the opium of the people?
Opium of the masses, yeah. Max Muller. No, not Max Muller.
Karl Marx.
Karl Marx, yeah. Karl Marx said that. Religion is the opium of the masses. Yeah.
Yes, I believe sense gratification is the opium of the masses.
Exactly.
Because it is like a drug, they get possessed.
Exactly.
You know? And like you said, it leads to anger, and anger, you know, these are the three gates to hell, anger, lust, and greed. They get so possessed and wrapped up in it. It's.
What did you say, Jiva? What was the statement you made?
Religion is the opium of the masses. It's a famous statement by Karl Marx.
Karl Marx, yeah.
But I countered that sense gratification, you know, the lust, mm-hmm. wanting more and more, greed.
This is very true, Mataji. Actually, especially if we look in the Western countries, not so much in India, but now in Western countries, we see that governments give this unemployment benefits, whatever monthly they give. And there are young men, and I also know a few people here in US. They're young men, they can get jobs, but they don't get jobs, you know, because they're getting free money. And what they do is, instead of using that money for, you know, buying necessities, they basically go and do, you know, get these drugs, and then they get high on the drugs. And because, you know, roti kapda and makan, it doesn't give any high to them. So they think that, just get drugs, get high, and, you know, so basically kama bhog parma, you know, it's like, as Mataji said, lust and sense gratification is the opium of masses. So that is actually true.
I mean, we all some sense gratification, but the excess, you know, accepting more than our quota.
Yep.
Yeah.
And the governments also kind of promote these kind of, you know, immoral behaviors also by giving these kind of benefits. You know, if you, in some of the European countries earlier, you know, when these unmarried women, they have had relationships with men and they will become pregnant. So what they will do is they will, you know, after the child is born, they will dump the child. So the government started giving, okay, these are single women, they don't have jobs. So give them some kind of, you know, like a monthly allowance so that they can maintain their children. But then what happened is, you know, this become like these women, they basically the students, they don't have money to sustain their education. So what they will do is they will become pregnant, they will get a child, and then they will get free money from the government. And, you know, they'll use that money to basically sustain themselves. So what they're doing is they're promoting immoral behavior by these kind of things. So in many European countries, actually, that is the norm. I was reading an article about this, that how in European countries, you know, people are exploiting these kind of facilities given by the government to the citizens. So, you know, you don't know where to stop when sense gratification and all these kind of things take over. You know, then it kind of goes in a very, chaotic way. You know, it's just as Prabhupada says that, you know, there's a very famous statement Prabhupada made that, missing the statement. Anyway, he says, what is the ban of, if I remember next time, I'll mention it. I read it in one of his purports. It was very nice.
But I liked what you said about glorification of sin in this age also, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I mean, like the movie stars and glorification of all the sinful things that they do is glorified, you know, that's
so much.
Kind of like the standard, yeah. I mean, these movie stars, I mean, you know, like it's almost like they dress like, you know, scantily, and all that is considered now fashion and the order of the day, you know.
Yeah, and as Mataji and Prabhuji is saying, I mean, in this age of Kali Yuga, they will not consider about the character of the person, how much wealthy is a person, that matters, and they glorify or based on the wealth, how much person has.
And these kind of people are the role models of society, you know.
Yes, Mataji, true.
Okay, so what time? Any other questions, comments? Okay, all right. If not, then we can stop here. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for joining. Vancha kalpata rubhyascha kripa sindhyubhya evacha patita naam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha. One last thing before we log off. Tomorrow we have Radha Ashtami, so we won't be having Bhagavad Gita class, but we will be basically telecasting on Zoom whatever is happening at the temple. So at 6 p.m. the program is going to start
6 p.m.
tomorrow for Radha Ashtami. So we won't have Bhagavad Gita class, but we will have Radha Ashtami celebration tomorrow, and those who are not attending in person, they can join on Zoom, and you know, they can see the festivities.
Thank you.
Today is Chaitanya's birthday, Madhav Kanta Prabhu.
Oh, let's sing Hare Krishna. Uh-oh.